You get a hold of the Word of God, the Spirit of God, the grace of God. I'll have some more of that. That tastes pretty good. Well, His Word says He's good, but I've tasted the good Word of God. I've tasted the grace of God. He's good. The testimony I have for you is God's good. God is good. Well, the devil's bad, but God's good. The devil's bad, but God is good. And I've been translated from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. I've been translated from death to life. I've been translated. Colossians 1:14 tells me that. I've been translated. I've been translated. That's past tense. I've been translated. I've been moved. I've been, somebody says there's a shift coming. I've already had one. I think they ought to get saved. I hear a lot of people talking about what's coming, and I think to myself, you need to get saved. It's already happened. Oh, it's already happened. There's a shift coming. I've already had one. I'm translated. I've been translated from death to life, from darkness to light, from the kingdom of Satan to the kingdom of God. In the Amplified Bible, it says the kingdom of the Son of His love. The Son of His love. God so loved. And Jesus is in me and I'm in Him. Blessed be God. I've come out from among all the others. I'm not even among them. I've been translated. I'm new. In Him I live. In Him I move. In Him I have my being. Paul said, I was crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. But he said, it's not me. He said, it's not me. It's Christ in me. On another occasion, he said, Christ in you, the hope of glory. I've been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but the Son of God, the faith of the Son of God. Well, I'm translated. Colossians 1:14 tells me that. And I'm enjoying it. God's a good God. I've come out from the bad into the good. And I've got dominion over the bad now. Found that out. I found that out. Jesus came along in Mark chapter 1. They said, this is new. The devils even respond to Him. He has power over them with just His word. They asked the question in Mark chapter 1. They said, what new doctrine is this? What new thing is this? Even the devils are subject to Him through His word. Well, I found out they're still subject to Him through His word and by His name. He said, in my name, cast out devils. Glory to God. I've come out of the devil into the Son of God's love. I'm in Him. I'm in the Son of God's love. God's a good God. I said, God's a good God. God's a good God. I'm in the kingdom of goodness. I'm in the kingdom of goodness. For the Lord is good. His mercy endureth. How long? That's a long time. John said that we have eternal life in us now. Newness of life, eternal life, now. Eternity's a long time. I've got that life in me now. John said that. Now are we the sons of God or the children of God. And the life we now have, now, not going to get it. When this body dies isn't when I enter into eternal life. I'm already there. He's already put a treasure in me. And Paul said it's a glorious treasure. More glorious than that light on Moses' face. We've got a treasure. I've already got the glory in me. I've already got the life in me. I've already got Jesus Christ in me. in him. I'm in him and he's in me. Some don't know. They don't understand. Seems like a great mystery. Well, Paul said so. He called it a mystery. And the devil, he didn't understand it. He could read the Old Testament. But the carnal man doesn't understand the things of God. He could read it, but didn't understand it. If he had known, he never would have crucified the Lord of glory. If he had known, well, it's prophesied in the Old Covenant. Why didn't the devil read that? He did, but he didn't understand it. And some things were hidden from man, because man would have spouted it out, messed it up. Mary pondered things in her heart. She didn't say everything out loud. Can somebody say amen? That's one reason speaking in tongues is so powerful, because if you said everything that you could in English, you'd mess it up. The devil would eavesdrop, listen in, and know the plan. Powerful praying. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14, when you pray in an unknown tongue, you pray mysteries. The Amplified Bible calls them secrets. I don't know why people wouldn't want to do that a lot. The devil fights it, and people go along with that and fight it too. I don't understand why you'd want to fight talking a secret over with God. I do that a lot, and I don't mind not always knowing what I said. Sometimes the interpretation comes, but see, the devil doesn't know what we said. It's a mystery, the wisdom hidden in God. Well, this glory was a mystery. It's a mystery, Christ in you, the hope of glory. How can you be in him and he be in you at the same time? It's a spiritual truth. I'm in him spiritually. He's in me spiritually. I've got something on the inside that's bigger than anything that you can see on the outside. Greater is he who is in me than he that is in the world. I'm a whole lot bigger on the inside. I'm prettier too. I'm bigger on the inside. I'm bigger on the inside. I'm bigger on the inside. He's in me. When I'm weak, then I'm strong. The power of Christ resteth upon me. Hallelujah. Just have a big time. Whatever I face, God's faithful. He'll show a way of escape. Blessed be the name of the Lord forever. I said, God's a good God. He's a very present help in the time of trouble. Why should I fear what man should do unto me? When God's for me, God's with me, God's in me. And greater is the one on the inside. And I always have access to a spiritual guide. He'll show me the way. And that's why I listen. That's why I pray. Because I've got a big one on the inside. God is a good God. Oh, my. There's not any problem I face. But what, according to his greatness and his grace, I'm able to face whatever comes to this place. However I go, wherever I'm led, I know his word. I'm bountifully fed. I am equipped. And those are words of victory that escape from my lips. I can face whatever comes through the power of Jesus Christ, God's love shown through his son. And he's in me. He's in me. How about you? He's in me. Turn and tell your neighbor, he's in me. What's he doing in there? What's he doing in there? Paul said, not enticing words of man's wisdom. A demonstration. When I tell people about Jesus, I'm looking for something supernatural. Just words. People in cults can give words. And they can be bold to witness about what they believe. Did you hear what I said? People in cults can be bold to witness about what they believe. I'm looking for something supernatural to reveal that Jesus is different from Buddha. Jesus is different from Muhammad. I'm looking for a way to demonstrate he's on the inside. He's in there. He's on the inside. And he's a great one. Whew. My, my, my. God's a good God. Turn and tell your neighbor, God's a good God. One of the biggest lies that the devil has fed to the church is whatever happens to you, God allowed it for some purpose. The misunderstanding of Romans 8:28 is one of the biggest lies that the devil has presented to the church that the church has swallowed. It's whatever happens, there's a reason for it, and God's going to work it out and make it good. And then it works out differently, and they'll sometimes try to figure it out. Well, I know God's a good God. I just have to trust him. And all the time, the devil's whipping up on them. My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. We ought to have enough sense to know what's good and what's not. Well, that's not good. God didn't do that. God didn't kill that little baby. God didn't send that tornado that destroyed the whole city, community, neighborhood. God didn't do that. We ought to have enough sense to know what's good. That's not good. God's a good God. God's a good God. Can somebody say amen? Jesus said, there's two men. One came to me and heard me say, he did them. Another man came to me, heard me say, he didn't do them. Storm hit both houses. One of them fell, one of them didn't. He didn't mention God one time. He didn't say God sent the storm. He didn't say it was God's will. The one that was protected, got protected, is God's will. That the one that was destroyed, got destroyed. That was God doing that, God's will. No, he said somebody did the word and somebody didn't. God's a good God. He's given us the provision to avoid things that are not good. We ought to have enough sense to be able to realize that's not good. And he is good. Therefore, I should submit to God and resist what's not God. That's not God. And I'm going to resist that, not accept it. Not accept it. Well, God's doing this to work things out for my good. That's not good. Resist it. Well, I'm just going to let God work his wonders to perform. We don't always understand. My people are destroyed. God's a good God. We ought to have enough sense to know. Some evangelist years ago, he was in a big meeting. Conference, convention. He was one of the speakers, or else he had an opportunity to speak for a moment before the main speaker. Maybe he was the main speaker. But he told about how he put up this gospel tent, big tent. And wind came along. You know, maybe not a tornado, but a big wind came along, storm, blew his tent down. And he said in front of the thousands of people in that convention, I don't know if that was God or the devil. That's why Christians are so confused. It's because Christian leaders are confused. God's not in the business of tearing down gospel tents. He's in the business of putting them up. The devil is the one who wants to tear them down. But he got up. I'd be embarrassed. Here this big name preacher got up in front of thousands of people, many of them ministers. And he said, admitted in front of all of them, I don't know if that was God or the devil. Well, anybody with half sense ought to know what's good and what's not. You can eat some food and you can say, well, that's good. Sometimes you don't even eat it. You smell and say, that's bad. That's bad. That's spoiled. You know, that oil is rancid. When's the last time you cleaned that grease, that fryer? You can smell it. You can taste it. That's not good. But then if it is good, you want more of it. Well, the gospel tent, I don't know if that was God or the devil. You want somebody like that, just sit down. He's preaching to congregations. No wonder Christians are confused. when Christian leaders are saying, I don't know if that was God or the devil that tore my tent down. God's a good God. And when something comes along that's not good, he told us to resist it. Old covenant I've set before you. Life and death, blessing and cursing. Now you choose. My people are destroyed for a lack of choosing the right thing. That's what it could say. Amen. God's a good God. You know, old Roberts got into trouble. Many years ago, he came along with that one of his sayings, one of his themes. In fact, my parents had that little plaque up on the piano. God is a good God. You remember that? Got that from old Roberts. You know, you support his ministry. He'd send that to you in the mail. My parents got that. I don't know if it was daddy or mama, but it was up on the piano for a long time. That was just a fixture in our home. God is a good God. You know, old Roberts got into trouble with other ministers and Christian leaders over that. Now, years later, we don't get in so much trouble. Some things start off slow because it bucks the traditions of men. You can come along and say Romans 8:28 has been misunderstood. That'll buck the tradition of men. It'll start off slow, but finally people start to get a hold of it. Jesus, when he said, let's pass over and go to the other side, and a storm kicked up, he didn't say, well, God allowed this for some purpose. Maybe God doesn't want us to go to the other side. This is his way of showing us. But people will have things happen in their circumstances and they'll rationalize and reason it. Well, maybe this is God's way of showing me. His word and his spirit is his way of showing you. Be led by the Spirit of God. Have the understanding of the word of God and have enough sense to know what's good and what's not good. And then submit to God and resist the devil. Jesus saw that storm is not good. And when they woke him up, he rebuked it. And then he rebuked them for not rebuking it. Amen. But people today, if I was with some Christian leaders I know, they'd be trying to figure out why God allowed it. There's some purpose for it. Everything happens for a reason. This is God's. It's not his will that we go to the other side. This is his way of showing us. I know Christian leaders that would be saying that. Jesus rebuked you. That's what I'm going to be doing. Boy, sit down. I'm going to rebuke this thing. We're going. When we were on the airplane recently, both coming and going, I'd whisper over to Susan, let us pass over and go to the other side. We're not going to have any hindrance. We're not going to get up in the sky and then crash. We're not going to go halfway over and sink. We're going to pass over. That's what we're going to do. Amen. Something comes up. You submit to God and resist what's not God. The devil wants you to accept it. He wants to fool you and to get you thinking that God did it or God allowed it. He wants to be in subterfuge and in hiding. He wants to camouflage himself and he wants to appear as an angel of light and get everybody to think, well, God is behind this. God's doing this. And that way you don't resist it. If you're wondering at all if God's allowing it for some purpose, you are not full 100% in your efforts to resist it. You've got to resist steadfast in the faith. And faith knows. I'm submitting to God, and he's good, and I can tell this ain't. I'm resisting it. I've got his word, I've got his spirit, and I've got the anointing and the power, and greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I'm resisting this. I'm resisting this with the faith, the shield that quenches every fiery dart. I'm also resisting this with praise that steers the enemy and the avenger. I'm praising God in everything. I'm giving thanks. I'll just lift my hands right now and praise God for his goodness. God's a good God. I'll praise God for his holiness. I'll praise God for his victory. The victory that overcomes the world is the faith that comes by hearing his word. I praise you, God, for your word. I praise you, God, for your spirit. I praise you, God, for your presence. I praise you, God, for your power. I praise you, God, for your promise. I praise you, God, for your provision. I praise you, God, for the anointing that destroys the yoke. I praise you, God, for the authority in the name of Jesus. I praise you that you're a good God, and I have victory even in the midst of the storm. I have your presence and your victory. I'll feel no harm and have no alarm because you're faithful. You show me a way to escape, and I'll give you praise. I'll give you praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's the victory that overcomes the world. My, my, my. God's a good God. Can you say it out loud? God's a good God. Can you say it again? God's a good God. Jesus on one occasion in Matthew chapter 7 said, if you're evil and you know how to give good gifts to your children, and you do, don't you? I mean, even in the natural, people who aren't divine, people who aren't pure, people who aren't holy, people who aren't filled with the presence of God and the love of God and the grace of God and the goodness of God. Jesus said, even people that are in the natural, evil, you know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more? How much more? That's in Matthew chapter 7. I have that underlined in my Bible. How much more? I love that phrase. How much more? Say it out loud. How much more? Say it again. How much more? Say that again. How much more? What does that mean to you? How much more? I mean, is it the same? If something is more, is it the same? Well, you know how to give good gifts to your children. Well, then God's going to do the same as you. No, he's going to do more than you. And you give good gifts to your children. Well, then God's just that way. He'll give good gifts to us. No, he's more than that way. James said it this way in James chapter 1. Good gifts come down from above, the Father of lights. Every good gift and every perfect gift comes down from above, the Father of lights. In him, there's no darkness at all. He's a God of light. It says there in James chapter 1, run verse 17. He doesn't vary. There's not even a shadow of turning with him. He doesn't vary. It says there also in James chapter 1, when you're tempted or tested or tried, don't say God did it. Tests and trials and calamities and adversities and challenges. Now the trying of your faith is precious. It's more precious than gold. And gold is tested. Faith has to be tested. God knows that. But 1 Corinthians 10:13, it says he won't let you be tested above your ability. That is when you're walking in fellowship with him. The devil's on a leash for the child of God walking in fellowship with the Lord. It doesn't say he sends it or he puts it on you. I heard somebody say recently, God won't put more on you than he knows you're able to bear. And they were trying to quote it, 1 Corinthians 10:13. 1 Corinthians 10:13 does not say God did it. James chapter 1 says, don't you err in saying that. Don't err, my brethren, in saying when a man's tempted, he's tempted of God. James chapter 1 says, don't err. Don't make that mistake. Don't be wrong saying, well, God did it. No, 1 Corinthians 10:13 says God won't allow it. Whatever you're able to bear, God knows that. Whatever you're able to endure, God knows that. And he won't let you have any test or trial but what you're able. That's why I can rejoice and count it all joy. That's why I can be of good cheer and rejoice. That's why I can realize when I'm weak, I'm strong. The power of Christ resteth upon me. And like Paul said in 2 Corinthians 12, I'll glory in tribulation because I've got now the opportunity to demonstrate the power of God. God's a good God. And he'll not let me be tested above my ability. He'll show me the way of escape because God is faithful. James said, every good gift, every perfect gift cometh down from above, the Father of lights. And don't err, my brethren, and said, when you're tempted, you're tempted of God, because he does not vary, not even a shadow of turning. God's a good God. God's a good God. And if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more? How much more? He's not just as good as you are. He's more good. Whatever you could want to do for somebody to show them goodness, God is more good than you. How much more? And he doesn't vary, not even a shadow of turning. The Amplified Bible there in James chapter 1 says, as in an eclipse. His light will not even be eclipsed. He doesn't even allow an eclipse. There's not even a shadow caused by an eclipse. He's the Father of lights, and he's beaming. Ever willing. Always able. And ever willing. The leper came to Jesus and said, if you will, I know you can, make me clean. In the Greek, it says, if you want to. I know you can. If you want to. I know you can. If you want to, I know you can, make me clean. And the Greek says, Jesus answered and said, I want to. I want to. I want to. He always wants to. Amen. Because God's a good God. If I can just remind you and exhort you again today, God's a good God. Maybe old Robert's got into trouble. Maybe I'll get into trouble. But God's a good God. And he doesn't vary, not even a shadow of turning. I don't know if that was God or the devil. Anyone with half sense ought to know. That's not good. Well, was that God or the devil? Tore down my gospel tent. God's a good God. And you're to submit to God. And did you resist that? You can't resist if you don't know. I'm wondering if that was God. Well, you're not really resisting the devil if you're wondering. I'm to submit to God and resist. Glory to God. One way I resist is with the power of the word. One way I resist is by the power of the name. One way I resist is with the power of praise. I'll praise my God. In the midst of tragedy, I'll praise my God. In the midst of turmoil, I'll praise my God. For he is worthy to be praised. His anthems to be raised. I will give my God eternal praise. For he is eternally worthy. His mercies are new every morning. His grace is unto 1,000 generations. God is a good God. He's full of compassion. Psalm 145 says. He's of tender mercies. There in Psalm 145, it says, the Lord is good to all. The Lord is good to all. He's full of compassion. When you're full of something, that's what comes out of you. Amen. You kick the cow's bucket. You're milking the cow, if you ever have or seen it done. You get nearly full. You're ready to finish, you know. And maybe she's ready for you to finish too. And she shifts her weight and kicks that bucket. What comes out of the bucket is milk, because that's what's in the bucket. When the devil kicks your bucket, monitor yourself, because what comes out of you is what's in you. I don't mean when everything's going good. James said, count it all joy when you fall into divers temptations. When the devil kicks your bucket, monitor what comes out of you. If it's fear, You better examine that and address that and do something about that. If it's anxiety, you better examine that, address that, do something about that. If it's retaliation, if you're going to render evil for evil, then you better examine that and address that and do something about that. Because on the inside of you is the holiness of the Lord, the goodness of God, the glory of His presence, the grace of the Son of His love, His Word, His Spirit. God is on the inside of you, and the presence of God. He's full of compassion. Well, I want to be like Him and be full of compassion. Get next to me. Rub up against me. Just let compassion ooze from me. He's full of compassion. I can come boldly to the throne of grace and obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need, because He's full of compassion and He's of tender mercies. God's a good God. There in Psalm 145, it says, the Lord is good to all. How many? The people He likes? His favorite ones. He has some pets. God doesn't have any favorites. He doesn't have any pets. And God is good to all. Even the sinner who repents and comes to God, they receive His mercy. Thank God for mercy, the throne of grace. Say it out loud, God's a good God. For the Lord is good, and His mercy endureth forever. Can you say amen, somebody? Amen.